Yeah, so...
Where'd Val go?
Tell us a story, but tell, from Sunday to Thursday, what happened?
Okay, so a week ago, a little bit more, 10 days ago, I got in touch with Jennifer, and I was told that the save it or shave it was, I was good. I'm free and clear. But the bad news was, we were just under or just at halfway to our goal of raising the necessary money for the second half of the church's website. So selfishly, I was excited, but deep down inside, I was really let down and disappointed because we still had a long ways to go. So I prayed about it, and I thought about it, and I decided that God spoke to me and said, put a deadline on it. Don't let them drag it out. And so I said Thursday. Jennifer said Thursday works. Then we have everything tallied before Sunday. We can make the big reveal one way or the other. And Thursday, Jennifer sent me an email and said, not only have we met our goal, but we exceeded it. But unfortunately, I was going to have to bring home a cord of 10W30 and move up the old hair clippers that I've used in 4 years. So, congratulations. We got the new church website on here. And I'm excited about that. And with our upcoming travels and such this summer, Mom is excited that she gets to show off her almost 30-year-old son who looks like a 12-year-old again.
Hey, in 30 years, that'll be important. Will
you? That's exactly right.
How long does it stay off, Will?
That's it.
One in there.
He knows that. I told him he looked just like Madeline, and he said, no, Madeline looks just like me.
So the tan lines on the jaw, it's not appealing, and I got carded for caffeine this morning. I didn't know you had to be a certain age to buy caffeine. But
stand up.
So, now that we've had our good laughs and yuckles and chuckles, by opening day of hunting season, it'll all be nice and smooth. But, in other exciting news, it is Pentecost Sunday.
Amen.
I know this not only because I've been reminded by lots of loved ones and church family members, but also because I see the signs out on everybody else's signs through town, and that's kind of exciting to me. We don't necessarily practice our faith in the same way as other denominations do, but just kind of bring it all home, putting things in perspective, the idea that our brothers and sisters in different congregations all over the world this morning are celebrating such an exciting time in the history of our church as a whole. So we invite you as we come together this morning to stand and join us in our opening praise and worship song. As you hear the words of the song, the songwriter wrote this actually about kind of what he saw as a child and growing up watching, what's his name? Billy Graham. Reverend Billy Graham. And so think about the words in this song as you sing them. It's kind of exciting. It's an upbeat song. So let's we believe together this morning as we open up the song.
Thank you.
you would please bow your heads with me this morning for a moment of open prayer together. God, we ask that you just fill this place with your Holy Spirit this morning, Lord. We're so excited to be here with so many blessings, so much grace about it upon us. So many reasons to be thankful, God. We ask you just fill us with that fire that we might do whatever it is that you have for us this morning. Send us forth to spread the message of the good news that you sent your Son to die for our sins, and we believe. Be with us in this place this morning, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Next song this morning is going to be Take In.
Oh,
just in case you are not going to be at the main service, the 11 o'clock service this morning, we are going to share with the congregation.
No.
We are going to be taking a donation because tonight at conference, in the days when annual conference begins in Shreveport, and at tonight's opening service, we are going to collection, I don't remember this, we're still in the old days, but the offering is going to be from each church a minimum amount that is going to go towards the kits that Unboard does, the United Methodist Community on Relief. And so they, you know, years ago, I remember at one point that we brought items and filled buckets and got all of that ready. But they are asking, and they said the minimum that we are looking for is 140, but of course, with more, with a larger donation, of course, we can have more kits. And so that's, if you're not going to be at the morning service and you want to make a donation before you leave today, I'll be more than happy to take it. And then we will put all of it together in the hangar. I will pick it up with us tonight.
Thank you.
Just make it to the church and then identify it as being home for. Thank you.
I suppose I'll use this. Typically, I use a little bit of light, but thanks. Probably going to want to use this itself. I'm just going to leave it all. The scripture I'll be reading to you this morning is going to be from the book of the Gospel of John, chapter 7, verses 37 to 39. I'll be reading to you this morning from the Common English Bible Translation. On the last and most important day of the festival, Jesus stood up and shouted, "All who are thirsty should come to me. All who believe in me should drink. As the scriptures said concerning me, rivers of living water will flow out from within him." Jesus said this concerning the Spirit. Those who believed in him would soon receive the Spirit, but they hadn't experienced the Spirit yet, since Jesus hadn't yet been glorified. Please bow. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the scripture this morning. We thank you for your servant, Brother Hank, for his musicians. We ask that you use the words in this scripture, the lyrics in these songs, the sounds that we make this morning. We may glorify your Son. We ask these things in his name. Amen.
All right. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I want to welcome you all to church this morning. I want to ask you, who has the Spirit this morning?
Amen.
We go to these ball games, we get the Spirit. Time to get the Spirit in here on Pentecost Sunday. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now, I tell you what, there was a grandfather who went to see his daughter and his brand new grandson. Hadn't seen the grandson in a long, long time. And so he walks in the front door, and the grandson's in a playpen. Of course, when the baby sees the grandfather come in, the baby starts jumping up and down, yelling. So excited, the grandfather does what a grandfather naturally does. Walks over, bend down, and picks the baby up. The mama walks out. His daughter walks out and says, "No, no, no, Dad, that baby's in trouble. They're in a timeout. They cannot get out of that playpen." The grandfather's sort of in the middle here. Got the baby wanting to be picked up. The daughter over there going to get mad if he picks her up. So you know what he does? He climbs in the pen with the baby. That's what he does. He climbs in the pen. I want you to know, this Pentecost Sunday, that's what the Holy Spirit does with you and I. He did it with Paul and Silas when they were in prison. He did it with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. How many guys were in the furnace? There were four. Who was that fourth one? Jesus, that's right. He was with the disciples in the upper room that day, right after he ascended. The Holy Ghost came and filled those guys. And folks, the world has not been the same since. And every time we talk about the Holy Spirit, the United Methodist Church, I always remember or always think that it's one of those things we emphasize the least in our Methodist Church. But yet, without the Holy Spirit, what do we really have? We don't have a whole lot of anything, right? So this Pentecost Sunday, I want you to remember some things that Jesus promised. If you would put the scriptures back up there, Will, we're going to take a look at these together. I tell you what's a good habit to do is just bringing your Bible on. And I would be preaching out of this thing every Sunday. I do, but I don't carry it. When I carry it, it's like kind of having a pistol in your hands. You know, Will? When you have the Bible, it is the weapon that we can use against the devil here. But the Bible tells us that Jesus makes a promise to his disciples and all that follow him. In verse 37, he says, if anyone is thirsty, if anyone is thirsty, who is anyone? If anyone is thirsty, you know the cool thing about God is he's not mutually exclusive. He's not going to exclude anybody that wants to follow him, and certainly not anyone that wants to receive the Holy Spirit in their life. He's not mutually exclusive. He accepts everyone, like the song says, red, yellow, black, or white, we are precious in his sight. Everyone's invited. But you know what word I hate? I don't like it. I don't like the word rejection. How many of you have ever experienced rejection? I don't like it. You guys remember back when you were dating? Y'all remember those things? You don't remember that? Josh never had a problem with rejection. I tell you what. And that was all it was. We don't know anything about it. Now, Megan, how many times did it take him to finally pull you in? So she's backing up the story. If you need a ride home, we'll take you home. Rejection. We all experience it, don't we? You know, when I was a little boy, I was born with pigeon toes. That's what I was born with. I had a golfer ask me a long time ago, he said, Hank, what's your handicap? And I said, well, I was a pigeon toe. You know, he just kind of laughed and chuckled. But if you've ever seen the movie Forrest Gump, and when he was a little boy and he wears those braces, that was me. I had to wear those braces, man. And you see that because of those braces, he also learned how to dance like Elvis. If you know Forrest Gump, you know he was an Elvis fan, right? I had to wear those growing up. Because I wore those, I was a little bit slower than the other kids, wasn't as athletic as the other kids, couldn't run as fast as the other kids, and because of that, I didn't feel like my father accepted me. My own dad, my own flesh and blood. I remember many times coming home and him coming home and be ready to go out with him and do something, but he would grab his friend and everything would go, and I would be sitting at home. And there were so many times in my own personal life I felt like my father rejected me. Just because I didn't measure up to what he thought a boy should be. And I had to live with that rejection all my life. Even into my early 20s, I had to live with that. And they actually caught it as I was going through the Board of Ordination of Methodist Church Charter. They saw a little flare of anger, and through counseling, they saw, this goes back to your dad. You need to do something about that. And so I did. And since that time, my father and I have worked on our relationship. Today, we are over it. I'm over it. We love each other. But that rejection thing's pretty heavy, isn't it? You know, in 2005, Hurricane Katrina came through here in August. Ian McCollum was in one of those big old Coast Guard helicopters, and he was given orders to fly over the city of New Orleans because 80% was underwater, and their job was to rescue people off of housetops. The first day they went out, they rescued 89 people. And they did it for 4 days. The fourth day they were sent out, and guess how many people they rescued? Zero. You know why? Because when they flew to the people that were on the housetops, they rejected the rescue. They just wanted water and food. That's all they wanted. And so when the helicopter pilots flew off, they knew those guys were going to be left there, and they probably wouldn't make it, and many of them did not make it. Because they rejected the rescue. I want you to know that the Holy Spirit is always in church, and he's offering to rescue each and every one of us. But for some crazy reason, we seem to reject his services to us. As individuals, as churches. Hey man, why do we do that? I don't know. Jesus said to anyone, John 3:16, for whosoever believeth in me, for whosoever. I used to have a t-shirt that said, I'm a whosoever. Who's a whosoever this morning? Are y'all whosoevers? You better be whosoevers. Because Jesus died for us and he sends his Holy Spirit to us. The Bible says also in that verse 37, look up there. It says, if anyone is thirsty. Now, we live in Louisiana. How thirsty do y'all get? I know the Sonic up here makes more money than any Sonic in the state of Louisiana. Did y'all know that? Am I right? It makes a lot of money, doesn't it? It's one of them that's up there that makes more money than anybody, any other Sonic. You know why? Because we're thirsty. And you can go through the Sonic and you can get a raspberry sweet tea with lemon. or you can get a Coca-Cola, or you can get any type of variety, crazy kind of drink you want. Why? Because we're thirsty. I had a couple of guys come on my yard. They were only out there 30 minutes, and then they came up and knocked on the door yesterday. Hey, can we have some water? It was hot yesterday. We needed a drink. Have you been thirsty this morning? Have you ever really been thirsty, though? Josh, you ever been thirsty on the battlefield? I mean thirsty. I mean, you would do anything for water. Have you ever been that thirsty?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What was water like when you finally got it? That's right. How thirsty can you get? You can get very, very thirsty. Ask the people that were trapped in the building of the Twin Towers that went down at 9/11, how thirsty some of those folks got. Waiting to be rescued, what they were willing to drink. As they were waiting for their rescue. Oh man, we can get thirsty. There was a little guy that fell off an aircraft carrier a few years ago and he ran in sea. How do you fall off an aircraft carrier? I don't know. After 24 hours, the Navy stopped the search. Right? 48 hours passed. 72 hours passed. He's all by himself. The Navy has something that you can put on your belt, though, that will inflate and give you some sort of flotation, you know, while you're out at sea. Okay? And so that's what he's doing. 72 hours later, four Pakistani fishermen found him. 72 hours later, he was almost delirious. His tongue was swollen. His lips were parched. They pulled him out. Years later, he was on the national news, and they asked him, how did you survive? He said, all I could think about was water. 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 I had to have water. Folks, let me ask you something. How many of you believe it's possible to be physically thirsty? That's a dumb question. We know we get physically. Now let me ask you, how often do you get spiritually thirsty? Spiritually dry. Brother Hank, I don't like going to church sometimes. I don't like reading my Bible. It takes too much time for me. I don't like doing those things sometimes. Maybe there's something dry in here. And Jesus says, if we will ask him, or if we do ask him, he will give to all who are thirsty. All who believe will come to me and drink. Now the last thing that he offers here is not only to everyone who is thirsty, but he says to them in verse 39, he gives my Bible. Or verse 38, it says, he who believes in me, as the scripture said, from his innermost being will flow rivers of living water. Not just a creek, not just a stream, not a pond, but a river of living water. Now, I like to fish. Probably not as crazy as Will is or Josh, but they like going fishing, or anybody else that likes to go fishing. I like to fish. I grew up fishing. When I was a kid, we went out fishing this pond, and I was thirsty. You know, there was a time they didn't bottle water. I'm old enough to say I lived during that time. They didn't bottle water. And so when you went hunting or fishing back then, you didn't have anything to drink unless you put it in the thermos, right? And off you went. We didn't have any of that stuff, so it's hot. And there's a creek that runs into the pond. I went over to that creek, and I picked up a handful of it, and I looked. It was clear looking. And I thought, this looks good. I'm hot. I'm thirsty, so I sit. I started drinking a little bit more. And I got my feel of that old creek water. And I looked way up the creek after I had finished. There was about five or six cows laying right in the middle of it. Hey, problem with Christians, we drink dirty water. We do. I'm reading this book right now. It's called Out of the Depths. One of the most fascinating naval catastrophes of all time happened July the 30th, 1940. Can y'all know what happened that night? July the 30th, 1945, brother. The USS Indianapolis had just delivered the atomic bombs. They were on their way back. They were traveling what they considered safe waters, right? They did not zigzag as most ships would back then to avoid submarines. They just went on a straight path. The guys were so at ease, they were sleeping on the turrets because down below on the ship, it was hot. And they would come outside and sleep on top. just after midnight, some Japanese sub spotted them, sank six torpedoes into their side. In 8 minutes, that ship went to the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. There were over 1,200 men on that ship at the time of the torpedo. 900 went into the water. 5 days later, just over 300 were rescued. What happened? Some of them died because of the torpedo. A lot of them died because of sharks. The pilots that were flying over and spotted and saw them being attacked by the sharks. And one guy went ahead and landed his little airplane right on the ocean, as dangerous as it was. It damaged his airplane. Couldn't fly it off level water. But you know what the others died of? Though they were surrounded by water, dehydration. So it killed a lot of them. They were dehydrated. The guy said, one of the 300 survivors said that some of the Marines and some of the sailors on board that ship, floating in the water about the third or fourth day, gave in to the challenge of not drinking salt water. And they began to drink it. They didn't just drink it, they gulped. And within a few hours, their bodies shut down. They began to become delirious. They went unconscious, and the sharks had a good meal. Isn't it interesting, the society and the world that we live in today is a lot like that old ocean water. There's so many things in this world that look good to you and I. And we take a bite of this and we'll take a bite of that spiritually, and bam, it hits us. Bam, it hits us. But God has promised to us not bad water, but water. And notice that word right there in front of water, living.
Thank you.
words just sink into you. It's a lightning crash that it is. Think about all that he is and all he's given us.
Close and pray this morning. Please bow with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Holy Spirit this morning being here in this place. We know that when there's at least two or more of us ragtag people that you've blessed with another day, that you're going to be here in our presence. The Holy Spirit's going to come down to the depths with us. He's going to be that grandpa that gets in our crib so that we don't have to be getting in trouble with the mom. God, we just ask that you empower us and guide us the rest of our day, the rest of our week, whatever challenges may come. When we pray for patience, you don't just make things easier for us, but you give us opportunities to be patient. I ask that you empower us with that Holy Spirit. Send us forth with the word and the message that it is that you have for us to spread it out. It's in your son's name we pray.
Amen.
Nifty 50s.